exist. Winso.
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 Brothers and sisters.
Transform lives.
And transform lives.
I want to welcome you back to life.
Transform lives.
Transform lives.
Winso. Back to the one.
And transform lives.
That can make your next chapter.
We exist to winso.
Winso.
Your best chapter.
Winso.
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 Transform lives.
And transform lives.
Transform lives.
Transform lives.
Transform lives.
And transform lives. We exist to winso.
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 Transform lives.
Transform lives.
Transform lives.
Transform lives.
And transform
lives. We exist to winso.
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 Winso. Transform lives.
Come on. I really mean it this time.
All of my EWC faculty, staff, and students, it is Wednesday, which means that it is our chapel hour, and we are excited about it. Listen, take a moment right now and hit the share button. Like, share, and even start a watch party if you like. Text somebody or tag somebody and let them know that we are on. Here it is, Wednesday again, our EWC Chapel Hour. Take a moment right quick, and just comment and let somebody know that you're in. Say good morning, say hi, whatever it is. Let's just kind of greet and fellowship as we are coming in. I'm so very, very glad that you are with us. If you are joining us for the very first time, thank you. Welcome. I am Pastor Jay, the campus pastor of Edward Waters College. I am the director of campus ministry and church relations. And I have an amazing team on my campus ministry, which is the creative worship team. And you'll see them kind of coming in and out on today's hour. Listen, we're going to go to our prayer and our scriptures in a moment, and then we're going to go through the rest of this power-packed, amazing hour that we have for you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we are alive and that we are well. Bless us in this hour. I pray, God, that you lift up some hung down head, that you give joy to some depressed spirit. I pray, Father, that as we are in here today, God, in this hour, that we feel your spirit, we feel your power, we feel your presence. We need you and nothing else, God, and that's what we are asking for you to give us in this hour. You for this hour. In your mighty, matchless name, we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, let's go to our scriptures. Listen, this is our time to confess. This is our time to be bold in our faith through our scriptures. The three that we do, come on, do them with me. Amos 9:13 is our first one in the Message version. Let's do it together. Ready, go. Yes, indeed, it won't be long now. God's decree. Things are going to happen so fast, your head will swim. One thing fast on the heels of the other, you won't be able to keep up. Everything will be happening at once, and everywhere you look, blessings. Blessings like wine pouring off the mountains and hills. Right now, type in the comments, I am blessed. Yes, I am. I am blessed. I want you to declare it. Come on. I am blessed. All right, let's go to our next scripture, Proverbs 4:25 in the Message version. Do it with excitement. Keep your eyes straight ahead and ignore all sideshow distractions. Listen, I want you to type something different. Hoping you can spell it. You college students, I'm determined. Type, I'm determined. Keep your eyes straight ahead. Ignore all sideshow distractions. Type, I'm determined. I'm determined to keep my goal and to reach my goal and to keep the faith. Here's our last scripture, Matthew 9:29 in the Message, in the King James Version. Be it unto you according to your faith. Read that one again. Be it unto you according to your faith. What does that mean? Here's what you're going to type. Type, my faith did it for me. Type it again. My faith did it for me. I'll say it again. My faith did it for me. Be it unto you, whatever it may be, according to your faith. All right, listen, let's prepare for Chapel News. Chapel News, here is Warren and Diana for our Chapel News.
What's up? It's your boy Warren Sapp.
And it's your girl Diana Sapp.
And this is your weekly Chapel News.
Reminder, our chapel services are strictly virtual, so please tune in every Wednesday at 11 a.m. on our school Facebook page, Ebel Waters College, and our campus ministry Facebook page.
What's up, Tiger family? It's your boy Warren Sapp with these same vital tips from CDC for coronavirus during these perilous times. Number one, please always be sure to wear your mask when entering on-campus buildings and facilities. And when you enter those buildings, classrooms, etc., your temperature will be checked. Number two, please, 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 if you have any symptoms, if you feel sick or under the weather, stay home, stay in your dorm room, and quarantine. Quarantine, quarantine. Number three, please be sure to wash your hands, sanitize your hands, and remain healthy and safe during these times. We hope that you all remain safe, and we love you guys.
Guys, interested in joining campus ministry? If so, please email us at campusministry@ewc.edu.
We exist to win souls.
Win souls.
Win souls.
Win souls.
Win souls.
Win souls.
And transform lives.
And transform lives.
Transform lives.
And transform lives.
And transform lives.
Win souls and transform lives.
Hey Tigers, voting season is finally here.
Yes, yes, that's right, that's right. Please be sure to cast your votes when the ballots open up and the polls open up. Your vote counts. If you want to see change, it starts with you.
Hallelujah.
Once again, it's your boy Warren Sapp.
And it's your girl Diana Sapp.
And this is your weekly Chapel News.
See y'all later.
Peace.
Thank you, Warren and Diana. Listen, if you want to add a news announcement for during our chapel hour, that will also air separately, the news will air separately on different platforms for EWC, please, 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 please send in your announcement at campusministry@ewc.edu. Again, that's campusministry@ewc.edu. We ask that you do that Monday prior to the Wednesday you wanted to air, Monday by 5 p.m. prior to the Wednesday that you wanted to air. Here is another great singer that's on our chapel ensemble, Miss Tasha. Listen, really prepare your hearts to be blessed by our chapel ensemble member, Miss Tasha.
Come on and put your hands together and celebrate God as we chase after Him, because we know we need more and more of Him each and every day. So God, we show you on today, God, that we're chasing after you no matter what. We're going to yet pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Woo! Let's go.
I'm chasing after you no matter what I have. Chasing after you, no matter what I have to do, 'cause I need you, Lord, more and more. I'm chasing after you, no matter what, 'cause I need you
more and more.
I'm chasing after you, no matter what, 'cause I need you.
Listen, we have some amazing, amazing gifts on that chapel ensemble. Thank you so much, Miss Tasha. Just an amazing gift of worship. Thank you again. Listen, we have another episode of Tiger Talk. We're going to keep this thing going. And listen, you need to interact. I want to know what you're thinking, how you're feeling during the Tiger Talk. So, hey, here it is, another episode of Tiger Talk. Hey, I'm Pastor Jay, and this is another episode of Tiger Talk. I have a very, very special guest in the house with me today. This is
Marquita Williams.
Marquita Williams is my wife of 14 years. Mm-hmm. Why are you so far?
Child.
All right, so we're going to be talking about a very interesting subject today. You ready?
I guess.
So we're going to be talking about sex partners, lovers, and friends. How do they correlate into a relationship? Can you have all in one, just one cancel out the other, and so forth. So what's your definition of lovers?
Lovers have a deep yearning or desire for one another and to be with one another. It's to me, it's like an infatuation. Just do anything just to feel compassion and love from the other person and to have that between the two.
So is that for marriages as well, that long-term relationships, is infatuation still there?
Yeah, I believe infatuation could linger. I think there are different levels to it. I mean, just like when we have different changes in our own personal lives, within ourselves, infatuation comes and goes.
Are you still infatuated with me?
Yeah.
Turn the camera.
Stop it.
So how about friends?
There's different levels to friends. You have platonic friends, or like, that's just my brother, that's just my sister. You have friends with benefits, whatever people define as benefits. And you have acquaintances, friends. You have Facebook friends. So with friends, I mean,
so is friends a requirement for a long-term relationship?
I believe it should be a requirement for a long-term relationship. Because once the infatuation wears off, it's like, do I even like you as a person?
So are you telling your story?
No.
Well, talk a little bit about how you've had relationships in the past.
Well,
have you had relationships where you are not friends with the person?
Yes, and we're not friends to this day.
So how was that? What was?
It was infatuation, or just the yearning to I want to be his girlfriend, or you know, I want to be connected to that person some type of way. And then once all of that wore off, and I got to see you as this person and as a lover or a friend, I had to cut ties or disconnect altogether.
Is it because you were not friends?
I would say it's because we didn't start off as friends. We started off immediately. Let's get to know each other, see if we're compatible. And then we may have been compatible for a couple weeks or a few months, and that was it. I was young.
So you're saying that for a long-term relationship, friendship is a requirement?
Yes. Now, I would say, you know, I have been in a relationship where we were friends first, and then that ended up being a longer relationship. And then we cut everything off again.
Are you still friends, or did you guys remain friends after you cut off?
Oh, yeah, we were friends for a while, but then, you know, we just kind of grew apart.
Okay.
But, I mean, it's no, I don't have any bad blood or anything.
So, we're no love loss.
Right. Right, I can see
you
being like, hey.
Got it. All right. Okay, so talk about sex partners.
Oh, what about it?
What was that?
I think it's just pure physical attraction. It's an itch that has to be scratched. And then it's just the excitement or the fulfillment of fantasy or fulfillment of, I just need this. Boom, bam, bam, and okay, I'm good.
Stop it.
So let me go through mine.
Okay.
Lovers, they want to develop a long-lasting, long-term relationship, right? And that comes with a level of tolerance and a level of patience, because you've stepped over into the realm of being a lover. A lover may start with lust, but a lover is beyond lust.
Right.
When you really use the word love, there's a totally different dynamic that comes with that.
Right.
So here's my philosophy, right? People don't change. Growth is slow. And adjustments are temporary. But love stands through it all. We got hot and bothered, so we had to switch.
No.
All right, so that's lovers. So as far as friends are concerned, being friends is vital. Because it really allows you to make a conscious decision as to whether or not you want to be in a full-fledged physical and emotional and mental relationship with the person. I mean, true friendship, not, you know, yeah, we talking.
Right.
Because that's not true friendship, because you're talking with the intent of being lovers.
Right.
Just like you would do with the buddy, you know what I mean, where there's no judgment there, I don't want anything from you, you know, there's no underlying ulterior motive, although we may be attracted to one another. But I mean, you're straight, hey, let's be friends. Did we? did we go through that?
We did go through that, even though I feel that there was an attraction. I think, it was an attraction on my part, but we did go through the friend, you know, it's my dog.
What?
Like, you're just my dog.
Oh, okay. So yeah, I think friendship is vital. Then sex partners. So when I think about sex partners, I think about an arrangement, a sexual arrangement.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it is. Nothing else. It's
booty calls or late night nightcaps.
Pull up.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, that's the new term.
Pull up.
Pull
yeah.
up.
Yeah. Okay. And let's get ducked off. You know.
Yeah. Okay.
Sex partners are sexual arrangements. Lovers are long term. I'm with you, and friends is a journey to get to know a person. Can you have all that in one?
I think you can, healthily, and then it can be an unhealthy attachment as well.
Explain that.
When I say unhealthy, it's because it can be disguised. You know, oh, I just want to be your friend. We're just gonna be friends, but you really know what your ultimate goal is, or...
And a sexual arrangement.
And it could just be a sexual, yeah. Yeah, I just want to be your friend, but then in the back of someone else's mind, you know, I'm just trying to make you number whatever.
So let me ask you this. Is the lover's part, is that something you fall into? Because often people connect with the person nowadays, mm-hmm. well, any day, because of the sexual arrangement that they're looking for.
Really?
I think that's true, and I think that, you know, like you say, the disguise is let's be friends, but I really know I want to sleep with you. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And perhaps eventually you fall into the whole lover's lane. But is that healthy? Is that natural?
It's a thin line between if it's healthy or if it's unhealthy, because you can be like with me. I found you attractive. You were good looking. You were clean, you were well-groomed, and I found you attractive. And then at the same time, I didn't want to cross that line of flirtation or being, you know, making it seem like I was easy or trying to get at you.
So why were you befriending me? Was that a disguise?
No. It wasn't a disguise. You were a good person. You were honest. You were...
You didn't know me, though.
I did know some things about you. And then just being around you, I could see that you were funny. You were upfront. But you weren't rude, but you were still forward. And I think I needed to get some of that. I didn't want any pacifying, but I needed some strength. And I felt like I could draw it from you.
Okay. The attraction wasn't there immediately.
Mm-hmm.
Not that you were not a good-looking woman. I just didn't. I didn't zero in.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
You didn't see me in that.
Right.
In that light.
Right. I didn't zero in, and there were reasons for me not to zero in.
Right.
But I just didn't zero in.
We will tell you those reasons in our new tell-all book.
Tell all what and then they but yeah, I just didn't zero in. Which was good, because probably really good for me.
Yeah.
Because I mean, all of you were, you know, you were already taken, but had I zeroed in with an attraction, or if I knew you were attracted to me, I would have used it to my advantage.
Yeah, you probably would have.
And I didn't know
because
you were...
Because of ego.
What?
Probably because of ego and pride.
What? And so, you know, I didn't know that you were attracted to me. Mm-hmm. And I didn't zero in to enough to see if I was attracted to you. So our connection was friends, mm-hmm. you know, getting to know one another. And you were able to keep your attraction, quote unquote, at bay. Mm-hmm. Came back from August until about March the next year.
That's about 7 months.
Yeah. Of just friendship. You know, we really became best friends. And then, of course, I was the first one to cross the line of flirtation.
Be careful.
Stop it.
This is what you got to be careful about. Who you start to be friends with. Because friendship...
It can blossom.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And friendship requires quality time.
Right.
And love comes from quality time.
Right. You can see people like, how in the world they get together? I wouldn't put these two together. But it's because they actually spent time. I mean, even Nut Professor, look at Nut Professor and what was her name? Denise, Jen Jackson. Who would put them together?
Right. But they were spending time together, yeah. You know, in the lab.
Right.
but I do think that the three can coexist. The sex partners, lovers, and friends, mm-hmm. And honestly, for a long term relationship, they all three must exist. All three of them will be at their peak, mm-hmm. at the same time.
Right.
And then there are times where two are not there.
Right.
But the one is holding the relationship.
Right.
And then there are times that one is not there, and the other two are holding the relationship.
Right.
You know, and then there are times that all three are very low, mm-hmm. and God is
prayer.
What's your three top turnoffs before you?
Okay.
In a man.
Okay. Smoker.
What's a smoker?
If he smokes.
Anything.
Anything.
How often?
Anytime. I don't want to smell it. I don't want to smell it on you. I don't want to see the effects that it's having on you. That's just. Mm-mm. Personality. If you were like just not a nice person or rude, I just can't. I don't want to get to know you. Honestly, their belief system. Mm-hmm. Their belief system. That's a huge turnoff, because if I'm thinking, you know, one track this way.
You're talking spiritual or period?
Overall. Spiritual, just practicality. If we're not compatible or on the same wavelength.
So, in the comments, what are your three turnoffs, females? You have another one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, what are your in the comments? What are your turnoffs? Go ahead. And then we're gonna go to the men.
Grooming. Yeah.
What about it?
It has to be clean. I'm more of a clean and crisp type girl. That's what I'm attracted to. I'm not attracted to, you know, the sloppily.
So you don't like urban?
You could be urban. I mean, Michael B. Jordan is urban, but he's clean.
Michael B. Jordan is her celebrity crush.
He is. There are certain looks that
I mean,
I'm like
goofiest looking dude.
No, he's
I've ever
not.
Seen.
There are certain.
Okay, so here are my three turnoffs for a woman. Lack of intelligence, lack of style, fashion. You know, you gotta have some pizzazz, some swag, some feistiness to your style. And lazy. If a woman seems slothful, and cleanliness, right? You can tell mm-hmm. how a girl will be at home.
Looking in her car.
Looking in her car. So. If her car is nasty, no. Yeah, no. Those are my four. And my celebrity crush is the all-time greatest Cardi B. In fact, I'm meeting up with her a little bit. All right, anyway, so that's our episode of Tiger Talk. If you got any other questions or comments or topics that you want to talk about, if you want to see the lovely Marquita, tell them a little bit about yourself first.
Okay. I'm his wife, mother of three. I'm a realtor. And I am...
Give me your website.
Oh, yes. DesiredHome.org. DesiredHome.org. I would love to assist you in purchasing your new home. Or your very first home. Or if you want to sell a home.
Okay.
Come back.
Get off.
I'm from Fort Lauderdale, 954. I attended Florida State University.
If y'all want to see more of Marquita, let us know. All right, this is an episode of Tiger Talk. We'll see you guys next week.
Bye.
All right, there you go. Another episode of Tiger Talk. I want to know what you want to talk about. What it is that you want to talk about? Who do you even want to see doing an interview with? Let me know. And if you want to be a part of Tiger Talk, if you have a topic that you want to submit, please submit it to campusministry@ewc.edu. Again, that's campusministry@ewc.edu. Here is Miss Tasha once again to bless our souls through song. Miss Tasha.
Gotta be where you are. Oh, I wanna be where you are. Gotta be where you are. Oh, I wanna be.
I wanna be right where you are, God. Use me as you will. Take me as I am. Yeah, yeah.
Hallelujah. Listen, once again, blessed tremendously from that. Hands up. Put those hands up there if you were just really richly blessed and ushered into the presence of God. Let's go to prayer. Father, thank you for your presence. Thank you for blessing us with your spirit and your anointing even now. Speak to us now as we prepare to hear from you through the word of God. You get the glory and the honor and the praise. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. I'm excited about this particular word that I'm going to give you today. God has spoken to me, and is more of a prophetic word, actually. And from that prophetic word that God gave to me, I give to you. We're still in the concept of building and prospering. Building and prospering. Building and prospering. I've asked you to do this the last 3 weeks. I'm going to ask you to do it one more time. Go ahead and type in the comment as a prophetic word and confession for yourself. It is my time to build and to prosper. Now, God gave me a word about May of this year, 2020, May of this year. And I had to sit with that word, and I had to see what God was saying to me in that word before I was able to share it. And I'll give you kind of how I got it. I work and serve as a chaplain at one of the local hospitals here, UF Health, which was formerly known as Shands, Jacksonville. And I've been there for about 7 years. And as a security measure, they have us to change our login passwords at least twice a year. And after you keep doing that on the regular, you got to kind of have to get creative. And so I actually began causing that to be a God moment for me. The changing of my password was a God moment. I would actually pray for a minute and say, God, okay, what are you speaking to me right now? And that would be my password. And God would often speak to me prophetic phrases that would guide the next season of my life. And so those phrases would be go now. Or those phrases would be prayer time. Those phrases may have been keep going. And those phrases became my passwords. This particular May, I did the same thing. Time to change the password. I would take a moment and speak to the Holy Spirit and ask the Holy Spirit to speak to me. What are you saying for me? And God gave me this word, which is the very same word. He is speaking to you in your season of building and prospering. Here is what God is speaking to you. This one word. God spoke to me the word transition. Transition. God is saying for you that this is your time for transition. He is preparing you for transition. And in that transition, it is important that you have a few things to guide you through this transition. When you look at a seed, as a seed goes from a seed to its blossom, there's something happening to that seed. It's not just a process. Of course, the seed goes through a process before it blossoms, but a process is the journey. But it goes through something even more important. It goes through a transition. The transition are the acts that happen in the journey. For that seed, when it comes out to blossom or to bloom, doesn't look like how it went in. You never look at an apple seed and says it looks like an apple, because no seed, or no apple seed or orange seed or whatever, no seed looks like its results. And how does it come from looking like a seed to looking like its results? It's transitioning. And I say to you right now in the name of Jesus that however you have begun this season in your life, after God is through transitioning you, you won't look like how you went in. Actually, you will look like more than potential. Most seeds are potential. But people keep saying of you that you got so much potential, they're saying to you, you have not become anything. So getting the compliment of you being of such potential is only a compliment maybe the first couple of times you get it. But if you keep getting that same comment that your potential, that means that you are unwilling to allow that seed to go deep into the ground, to go through its transition, to come out as a bloom, as a blossom, as a result. I'm going to give you some simple nuggets or things that you need to help you through this transition. First, one thing you need to first understand that God is up to something. We've gone through transitions just in this year corporately, but God is going to take you through a personal transition. But you got to think high and think godly about this. We've gone through transitions like you as students, all of a sudden going to virtual means when you were in the classroom. Even all of us having to quarantine, even people passing away so suddenly and so rapidly, and so many people all at one time, people losing their jobs and so forth and so on, people getting sick, transition after transition after transition after transition. And even when God spoke that to me in May, it kind of frightened me, to be honest with you, at first, because I thought negative. But then I was reminded that when God is taking you through something, God is preparing you for something, He's never preparing you for something negative. The Bible says, for we know the plans that God has for us. These are plans of good. These are plans to prosper us. These are plans to give us a better, greater, expected end. The Bible even says that for we know that all things work together for our good. So whatever this transition is personally for you, it's working for your good. It's going to turn out in such an amazing and an incredible and a better way for your life. Now, I'm going to leave you with these four things that I think that you should grab hold to navigate you and help you through this season of your transition. Here it is. In 2 Corinthians 5 and 7, let me give you this foundation first. It says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Let me share another scripture with you here. The Bible says in James 2:17 that in the same way, faith, if it does not have works, is dead by itself. I'll explain those two in a moment. Watch this here. For the Bible says these four things, I'm going to give you one by one. Next clip. The first thing you need to have in going through the season of transition is a certainty of God's voice. This is not the time to not be clear of when God is speaking to you, because in this time and season of transition, it's okay to have a multitude of counsel. For the Bible says that there is safety in the multitude of counsel. Having mentors, having confidants, having spiritual advisors, friends and family, mothers and fathers that can speak to you. But in this particular season, how God wants to bless you through your transition, you must have a certainty of God's voice. You need to know God's voice distinctively from any other voice. And as you are very clear of what God's voice, then you'll have the second thing. And the second thing is clarity of vision. You need to know where you're going, what your purpose for, and how you're going to get there. Where you're going, what your purpose for, and how you're going to get there. The Bible says, write the vision, make it plain. Listen, if you have no clarity of vision, then you will be wandering around aimlessly. You'll be wandering around wasting time. You don't have the opportunity in this season of your life to waste time. When you have a clarity of vision, then you know what to take into your life. You know what to keep out of your life. When you have a clarity of vision, you know the people that God's connected you with that will help you to where you're trying to go, and you'll help them to where they're trying to go. And then you'll be so clear to know whom not to allow to yourself to connect with, because you just don't have the time to waste. You're in a transition, and you need to come from that seed to that bloom, to that result. And with that, you need to make sure you're in the right soil to be able to do that, with the right people to be able to do that. You need not only a certainty of God's voice, you need not only clarity of vision, but you also need a boldness of faith. That's why I said to you in the scripture, 2 Corinthians 5 and 7, for we walk by faith and not by sight. What does that mean? There are going to be some things that you don't understand that God is doing. And let me even be even more clear and honest with you. There's going to be some things that you don't like that God is doing. But even in that, as you trust God, you have to have boldness of faith. I don't understand it. I would not have planned it this way, but God, I trust you. Thus, I step out on your word. I step out on faith. Listen, as a father, I have three children. My oldest child is 17. She's about to be 18. And I have an 11-year-old a daughter that's about to be 12. And I have a 10-year-old son. All of them are going to give me and my wife the great pleasure of getting out of my house eventually. And I can't wait. However, I've got to walk them through that, right? Watch this carefully. After a while in your life, God stirs up the nest, like the eagle stirring up the nest so that the eagle can get out and fly and soar. Here's what my wife and I are going to do. We're going to walk them through teaching them and training them. We're going to walk them to the edge of the cliff. Now, as we get to the edge of the cliff, there's a long walk before that as they age and as they mature. It's not just in the age number, but it's in their maturity. We're going to walk them through that, teach them lessons, teach them about life, and walk them slow to the edge of the cliff. We're going to give them responsibility. We're going to make them accountable to their responsibility. We want to teach them integrity and pray that they pray for wisdom from God. And as a father and as my wife, the mother, we're going to try to supply them as much material things that they need, money and whatever supplies that they may need to set them great for life. And they're going to take that slow walk all the way to the edge of the cliff. And we're going to get to that edge of the cliff, and they're going to see this whole big old world there. And we're going to dream, mother and father and child, at the edge of the cliff. And then we're going to push them off the cliff and let them fly. There are times in your life, and you got to be honest about this, that if God didn't push you, you wouldn't go. And God is saying, it's okay, for we walk by faith and not by sight. So God has prepared you with a word for your season. It's transition time. Prepare, because eventually God's going to push you off that cliff and require you to do the fourth thing. The fourth thing is have a discipline of work. A discipline of work. In that discipline of work, the Bible says, we read it already, James 2 and 17, for faith without works is dead. Faith without works is just a simple, fleeting hope. But you got to have more than a hope in this season. You've got to have works that makes your hope faith. Then it becomes faith when you got works with it. Put the work together. You got to work like it depends on you, but pray and have faith like it depends on God. Listen, I'm going to leave you with that. I don't want to go much further, because I want to let that seep into your spirit, because I want the Holy Spirit to speak to you in the days and the weeks and the months and the years to come, and these moments to come and these seasons to come, for this particular season, of what he is saying to you for your transition. You need to have a certainty of God's voice, a clarity of vision, a boldness of faith, and then lastly, a discipline of work. Let's pray. Father, thank you in the name of Jesus. You've spoken to us. This is our time to build and to prosper. And this is our season of transition. We trust you, God, and we thank you that if you've called us to a season of transition, there's nothing but greatness to come of it. And God, whatever that transition journey will be, we know that we will come out better than what we came in. Hallelujah. We thank you. We give you glory and praise. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Listen, thank you so much for being with us this chapel hour. I love you with the love of Christ. I love you with the love of Christ. Listen, make sure that you like this, share this, and listen, we will see you on next week, every single Wednesday here on Facebook for our chapel hour at 11 o'clock a.m. Let somebody know you love them, and there's absolutely nothing they can do about it. I'll see you next week.